As scientists work to contain the coronavirus, researchers are still trying to figure out where it came from. Early research suggests human picked up the coronavirus from animals, possibly bats, but it's not clear how the virus made that jump. Science journalist and author David Quammen has been tracking this. He joins me now on the phone. And David, I know you know a lot about this, but I am learning with a lot of other folks here. And a disease that can spread from animals to humans is called zoonosis. Coronavirus is a zoonotic disease. What do we know so far about the coronavirus and how it spread from animal to human?
Well, part of what we know comes from past experience with outbreaks such as SARS in 2002 and 2003. SARS was a very scary new virus when it first appeared in southern China. It was new to humans. It had to come from somewhere, and scientists eventually tracked the SARS virus to bats. Bats are the reservoir hosts, meaning the virus lives in them without causing symptoms. Now, that was part of what rang the alarm bell on coronaviruses. Coronaviruses, SARS is one, this is another. They evolve very quickly. They live in animals, frequently bats. And when we come in contact with bats, we invite those viruses to jump from bats into humans. Because they evolve quickly, they can frequently adapt to us and cause terrible trouble.
If it is, in fact, bats in this case as well, what is it about them that makes them these frequent hosts of viruses or reservoir hosts, as I believe you just called them?
That's right. Bats seem to be overrepresented as the reservoir hosts for a lot of these scary viruses. SARS virus, as I mentioned, MERS virus, Hendra virus in Australia, Nipah virus in Malaysia, now this one. What is it about bats? Well, a couple of things. First of all, bats are a very diverse order of mammals. One in every four species of mammal on Earth is a bat. So they are just so diverse, there's a better chance that a virus would come from a bat just because of those odds of being so diverse. But there are other things. A little bat can live 20 years. A mouse of the same size is lucky to live 2 years. They live, as you can see from your shot, they live in aggregations. They live very intimately bundled together with one another, a good situation for passing viruses from one to another. Mm-hmm. You talk about social distancing. Bats do not have social distancing.
They don't get that at
so
all,
they carry a lot of bats. They carry a lot of viruses. Their immune systems seem to be dialed down. Their immune systems seem to be less able to clear viruses. So bats frequently are the origin of these things.
So fascinating. I had no idea any of that information about bats. You know so much about not only them, but about this kind of transmission. And you've said before that coronavirus will not be the last transmission like this. Why not? Why can't we stop this?
We can't stop this because the world's wild animals are very diverse. They live in diverse ecosystems, and all of those wild animals carry their own viruses. When we come into contact with those wild animals, disturbing their ecosystems, cutting down forests, building timber camps, catching wild animals for food, we invite those many, many diverse viruses to jump from the animal host into us. We give them the opportunity. And as long as we continue doing that, these viruses will continue jumping into us and causing trouble.
David, as you're talking, we're showing just looping video of all the places that are empty now, arenas, schools, public places, streets. I'd love to ask you what we can do about this. And I'd like to ask you that question, both in the short term, as in what can we do with this current coronavirus situation? And then long term, is there something that we can do to try to stop zoonoses and reduce the risk of this happening again, even if we can't stop it altogether?
Right. Good question. Short term, well, you've heard it, social distancing.
Yeah.
In Italy, they call it stata in casa, stay at home. Social distancing will not stop this virus from spreading through our population, but, and again, you've probably heard this, it will flatten the curve so that our hospitals and our medical capacities are not overwhelmed. Social distancing, flatten the curve, and you're doing a favor to the community, you're doing a favor to your elders. In the longer term, we need more capacity to respond to these viruses and detect them earlier, identify them. We need support for institutions like the CDC in the U.S. and similar institutions in other countries. We need the buildup of the capacity to create test kits in large volume very quickly. We were unprepared for this one, despite all the warnings that came from scientists and public health professionals. We were unprepared because we didn't commit the money and the political will to respond, and we need to do that before the next one comes.
David Quammen, thank you so much for the advice. Thank you for making the time to be with us today.
You're very welcome. Stay well.
You too.
Hey, NBC News viewers, thanks for checking out our YouTube channel. Subscribe by clicking on that button down here and click on any of the videos over here to watch the latest interviews, show highlights, and digital exclusives. Thanks for watching.